ancient and modern, fast and furious, open and closed, local and foreign. That's the magical mix of the Parks two-day festival of free fun.
Park race weekend. This is the big annual bash, sometimes literally, when the drivers come to town to show off their skills on this unique road circuit right in the heart of the nation's capital. In racing terms, this place is steeped in history. Indeed, Dubliners have enjoyed the spectacle of racing in this park since 1929. It seems appropriate, therefore, that Irish Motor Racing and the Leinster Motor Club, who run this magnificent show, are guiding it more and more towards historic racing as the years roll by. But don't think for one moment this is going to be a leisurely display by old timers and old cars. These guys really race.
Last year we thrilled at the spectacle of the historic Grand Prix races, and as we've just seen, they're back at the park again this year, top of the bill. And the historic element has been further advanced this year with the inclusion of these beautiful 1960s 2-litre sports racing cars. But to find out a little bit more, we need an expert.
Norris.
Steve Lydon, you're coordinator of historic Formula One. Tell me a little bit about these beautiful cars.
Well, here at the park this weekend, we have a lovely selection of historic cars, the quickest of which by far are going to be these 2-litre Group 6 cars. And this car in particular, driven by the reigning champion Mike Wilds, it's a Chevron B3136 from 1975. The last of the line of the fabulous, fabulous 2-litre Group 6 cars that were so successful in the early 70s.
Wilds, a man with impeccable racing credentials. I was very impressed watching you out there in practice today. You actually broke the lap record here at the Phoenix Park. Well done.
Thank you very much. It's my first visit to Dublin and Phoenix Park. Slightly bumpy, but great fun, and thoroughly enjoyed it.
You're the reigning champion now in Group 6, and you were at one stage a professional Grand Prix Formula 1 driver, weren't you? Was it 74, 75 thereabouts?
That's right, yeah. I drove for Ensign and BRM at the end of 74 and the beginning of 75. Thoroughly enjoyed it. I achieved an ambition. I always wanted to drive in Grand Prix. I just wish I could have stayed there, but it was superb fun. That's why I drive racing cars, is purely for fun. It's nice when you get paid for it as well. But now I'm getting on in years, and I really class myself as two 26-year-olds, really. And I just thoroughly enjoy it.
They'll sell a PA3 with 320 horsepower of BMW M12 Formula 2 engine driving it along. A very, very serious piece of kit. You can see bodywork laid out to achieve the maximum downforce. Very slippery, very, very quick in its day. It's a very, very quick car to drive. Really something that you have to get hold of and drive. Make it do what you want it to do, because if you don't, you'll be doing what it wants very quickly.
It's a fantastic feeling to drive the car. Pure inspiration. You just, the power is unbelievable. Unbelievable.
You were out in testing this morning. How did you find the triangular circuit? A bit bumpy?
Very, very bumpy. Very, very quick. Unbelievably quick. The car was doing round about 146 miles an hour, and that's quick.
Beautiful car, the Chevron V8, designed by the late Derek Bennett. Very, very successful car in European 2-litre sports car racing. Very much the sort of car that privateers could use as well. Simple, straightforward, BMW 2-litre engine, Hewland gearbox. Easy to drive, very satisfying, very quick. And still, I can speak from personal experience, a fabulous, fabulous car to drive today.
So far, two British, one Italian, all beautifully built sports cars. But it has to be said that Ireland also has a very successful runner among these beautiful cars, and a voice of a man that's well known to many of our RPM viewers, and that's Arne Black. Tell me a little bit about the Crosley.
Well, Gareth, as you know, these cars are manufactured by John Crosley up in Hollywood in County Down. They were made for the 1966 Group 6 International Sports Car Class. And they made quite a few of them. These cars that you're looking at today, this particular one, is one of a new late run on the original jigs and molds. They've been very slightly altered to comply with slightly higher specification of safety.
How are you finding the circuit this weekend?
This car is surprisingly good on the circuit. We're third in practice, which quite surprised me, to be honest. I spent so much time turning around and reversing back from Dublin, I thought I wouldn't go to get a lap in. But it's very good over the bumps. It's particularly good down into the Furry Glen. It's flat all the way down and all the way back. So the car is handling really well down through there. And it's very pleased. It's going well. We're never going to beat somebody like Wiles, needless to say. You're only about 7 seconds a lap slower than he is.
Sunday's race is the pick of the two sports racing events. Mike Wiles on pole position, Jeff Williams and the Acela alongside him, then the Chevron V8 of Lauren Benson, and then our Arne Black with a camera board just being out-dragged by Ronnie Mabon's similar Crosley 9S. Down they go into Dublin Corner, and a great show being put on by these Group 6 2-litre sports cars. The two more modern cars out the front there, a little bit of touching, and a little MG midget right at the back, and that'll bring back memories for you, Brian.
Yes, you notice that was a rolling start as well, but Arne just didn't get it right, and going into the first corner, Mabon nearly took the nose off him. But the two quick boys, as Arne said, Wiles and Jeff Wilson. Jeff, a bad day yesterday, but looking good today. But Arne hanging on there in the little Crosley as they go down into the Furry Glen, just very late on the brakes, but watch the power of these guys. 320, nearly double the horsepower that Arne has, heading out towards Mountjoy, which is looked after by Alfa Romeo this weekend.
And that Chevron that is leading, a great piece of history in Ireland, because the very first place a Chevron ever raced was actually at Kirkuson. It was snuck over quietly from England to try it out, and of course it went on to great international glories. This was one of the last of the line, really. It's a 1975 car that Mike Wiles is driving. We're aboard with Arne Black on the main straight, touching well over the ton, probably about 140 before they go on the brakes. And the Acela, a very rare car, Italian design, really giving it a race. And Arne Black holding on extremely well, sliding the tail there.
Yes, the big ones up front beginning to light up their tires, but you can see that the Acela much better under brakes. Wiles a little slow there. They're coming off that short Dunlop straight, which is about 60 feet wide, onto a 30 footer. Now you'll see Black turn in, looks much narrower when you come off the Dunlop straight, but then back down, but already, and his spinner there, that's Ronnie Mabon just getting it all wrong. Similar car to Arne Black, lots of wheel spin. Will Benson get by him? Good battle, and Benson, who made that nonsense at the start, is getting his own back.
The Chevron V8 just making up ground, and they were owned by many people here in Ireland over the years. Alec Poole, Eddie Regan, Archie Phillips had a B16, which is the beautifully enclosed car, and Richie Healy, just some of the members I remember in a V8. But we're looking at Mike Wiles leading, and these were really classic days in sports car racing. There's the B8 just coming out of the trees. In fact, these cars were even actually rallied here in Ireland with a sort of chopped off nose version. Didn't do very well, a bit fragile on the rally stages, but superb on the circuits. And there's that beautiful little Lotus. And that really is a gem of a car, number 77. That was Alan McGregor from Scotland. And the Lotus 23B, possibly one of the nicest cars of that era. Ronnie Mabon there going a little bit haywire again.
Three times lucky, Ronnie. The Lotus, not unlike the Crosley, I don't know who copied who, but they're coming down again. You can see the Acela just under braking, back out again onto that short Dunlop straight, and this is going to be the closest finish of the weekend. I think Wiles gets it by a nose, or a baby the end of a nose.
And indeed it was Mike Wiles' second win of the weekend, but Jeff Wilson keeping him very much honest.
Well, it's not all stories and artifacts of yesteryear here at the Phoenix Park this weekend. In fact, there are some of the very latest products from Maranello in the Ferrari 50th anniversary parade. How did he get in the act? Former Grand Prix racers Stefano Modena and Christian Danner are here to demonstrate two of the most technologically developed racing cars of all time, the international touring car Alfa Romeo. Is off to meet one of my favourite Grand Prix racers, Jacques Villeneuve, the guy with the baggy baby grows and the Gaza hairdo. Get up, get up, get up, get up. 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 Here comes my guiding star to take me home.
Welcome to Phoenix Park, Jack. This is our big racing day and you have, what, 17 of those in a year? You must really enjoy it.
Yeah, I enjoy racing, of course. I love racing. What I love actually is driving. It's not everything that goes around it.
I believe it's very hard to get to know you, Jack. You're a very private person. Is it true that your own boss, Frank Williams, doesn't even know where you live in Monte Carlo?
He doesn't know exactly. He knows where I live, but he's never been there, so... But I think, yeah, private life is important to keep private, basically.
I agree with you. You were described to me as having an old head on young shoulders. How do you feel about that description?
For the job, that I think that's important, because you have to take it seriously, and it's important, you know, to have your head on your shoulder. But when I'm away, then I can, you know, I can become the kid I've always been, basically. And that's
good.
Great.
That's the bit I wanted to get to. Dare I ask you, what do you do outside Formula One on your days off?
Anything that everybody does, basically, computers and music are the three things I enjoy the most. But you know, when you get home and you need to cut off a little bit from the racing, it's important to either go out with a few friends for dinner and maybe for a night out, and to just cut off completely.
Exactly, let the hair down. Do you feel that it's vital to start very young in this sport in order to be good at it?
I think it is, because that way you can build more experience. And it's difficult to beat experience. Experience is something that stays ingrained, and then when you drive it becomes more natural. So the more things you can touch when you're young, the better it is. But at the same time, if you start too young, then you probably won't grow up normally. You're just...
Yeah. You were 15 when you joined the gym racing school?
Yeah. But that was a three-day course. The next summer I spent 3 months working as a mechanic in one of the driving school. So I could get, you know, a few laps in the car there, and I think that was important to do because it gives you a different eye on what's happening around you, and you're not just, you know, the little star that's racing. And so I think it's important to go through all those different things before you actually become professional at what you do.
So it's too late for me then.
Probably, yeah.
Okay, now down to the nitty gritty. I noticed a little change in your hair color. What brought that on?
I just woke up and felt like doing it. Maybe the first time I thought about it was after I watched Trainspotting or something.
Yeah. A friend of mine said that to me, yeah, that it was influenced by Trainspotting.
Well, I wouldn't say influence, it's just, I liked it. I felt like doing
Why
it.
Why not? Well, it still looks good, in my opinion.
Some people.
Thanks very much, Jack. It was a pleasure meeting you.
Very much a driver of today, but what about the drivers of tomorrow? Behind me here is the Phoenix Monument, the centerpiece of this magnificent park. And it's this glorious erection which has inspired the most coveted of all of the motor racing prizes, the Dunlop Sexton Trophy. Now this year, the outright winner will be selected by a different method. Each month during the season, a Dunlop driver is selected, and obviously it's from this coveted group of drivers that the eventual winner will be picked. Alan Tindall has been finding out more and indeed talking to the men of the moment.
So this is how the competition works. Each month, an Irish driver is selected to be racing either here or abroad. And those six drivers are brought together at the end of the year and one selected to become the Dunlop Sexton Trophy winner by a panel of motor racing experts. Well, the first man to come out of that hat this year was in fact Ed O'Connor. Ed, you must have been delighted.
Absolutely thrilled that I was picked out to be the first driver of the month.
Now, what sort of a season have you had?
I had four wins and 2 seconds and a third so far.
Now, what would winning the Sexton Trophy mean to you?
I suppose a lifetime looking at that. I thought I'd never do it.
I've had a fantastic season. I've won 7 races this season out of 7 starts with mechanical troubles put me out of the 8th race, but I couldn't have asked for better this season so far.
Now, you're quite serious about motor racing, aren't you? You want to go quite far.
Well, my ambition is to make Formula One, or if not, get as close as I can to it. I'm totally serious about my racing. I don't put anything before my racing.
And what would winning the Dunlop Sexton Trophy mean to you?
That would be a dream come true. Such a prestigious trophy. This season, I never thought I'd even have a chance of getting near the Sexton Trophy. And then when I won the Dunlop Driver of the Month for May, it was a bit of a shock, really.
Donal, of course, you represent the Formula Opel ranks and you are a Dunlop Driver of the Month.
Yes, I was delighted to be selected, which puts me in the chance, of course, to win the Sexton Trophy at the end of the year, which has to be my main objective.
Right, of course, this year has been very personally triumphal for you because you've come back from horrible injuries.
Yeah, it was very, very hard for me last year to watch everything going on, and I knew I wasn't able to race. I did try testing the car last year, but I wasn't able to drive it correctly. So this year, after a lot of hard training, I'm back at the wheel, and I must say I'm really enjoying it.
Kieran, you're the latest winner of the Dunlop Driver of the Month. Congratulations.
Thank you very much, Plum. We've had a mixed season so far. It started off fairly well. Had a couple of bad races, and now we've bounced back.
Now tell me about the Dunlop Sexton Trophy. What would that mean to you to win that?
Well, obviously it's a very prestigious award. It was a surprise to me now this morning. It was the first I heard of that I had been picked as one of the drivers. And it's, very much sought after award, so I'd love to get my hands on it, get my name on it.
There are 2 more drivers to be picked, so we'll have to wait and see whose sideboard the Dunlop Sexton Trophy will finally rest on this winter.
Ed O'Connor, one of the Dunlop Drivers of the Month, also, of course, leads the Dunlop Touring Car Championship, which we will be featuring in our next RPM from Mondello. None of the local races here, however, are rounds of the normal RIAC Championships. But does this deter our tin top heroes from having a charge through the trees? Never.
We're featuring the Saturday race for the Dunlop Touring Cars. Ed O'Connor's on pole position in the Renault, then alongside him, multiple champion Mike Cullen, who we're looking at the back window of. Dave Kerrigan, number 97, and then skipping a car because we're looking forward now from Kiernan Greenan's Peugeot. 2 more onboard cameras. This is in John Keeney's new Renault and in Mark Thurley's Honda Civic VTEC, which I'm afraid isn't working too well at the moment.
We're ready for the flag, on the drop of the flag, and on the drop of the flag, a superb start from O'Connor there in the yellow car on the left. Kerrigan tucking in the Honda, third place, blue, red and white car. That is Michael Cullen, multi-champion. And there, the car we missed out on the grid is Jonathan Files in the green and yellow Honda VTEC, being chased there by Kieran Green, who is working very hard indeed. So Jonathan Files first driving the Honda, and look at this, down the back of the park he just cruises by the multi-champion Michael Cullen in the Astra and up into third place, and he's hot on the heels of the more modern Honda VTEC, the 5-door with the 1800 engine. Quinton Wall there really getting pushed about by Alan Dawson. Now what a superb grid of touring cars. This not a championship round of the Dunlop Touring Cars. They're coming off that narrow one into the very tight corner down at Furry Glen, and again just on board McKinney, who's having good success. His first run, there's John on board, his first run in this new Clio Williams, 7th position on the grid and hoping to improve all the time.
And right on the back bumper of the man who won out at Mondello the last time, Kieran Greenan, and indeed a Dunlop Driver of the Month. But there goes Kellett, number 2, gone up a place, and we wonder, is John slipping back? Is he in trouble? John Keeney, who's had rotten luck in the last couple of seasons in the Dunlop Touring Car Championship.
Yes, it seemed much too easy for Gordon. Yes, he's looking for a gear, struggling for gear. Is a weak point on these Renaults. Unfortunately, John, not having a good run of the park, but the future looks good for this Renault.
So he pulls off on the main straight as the other stream pass, doing well over the turn. We're now joining the leader as they come down Coca-Cola straight, one of the fastest parts and narrowest parts of the circuit. And really, here comes two side by side. That's fairly brave stuff.
And surprise, surprise, look at the gap these three have pulled out on that multi-champ. Cullen holding that inside line, trying to keep Kieran Green out of the way. And here's his old adversary, Gordon Kellett, having a look down the outside. He'll want to get by Green, because I think it's a three-all job at the moment between all, closing the door nice and slowly. One weave as you close the door, two weaves, you're getting out of hand, Green. But the gap, as I say, Cullen just holding Green and off. Then Kellett, then Quinton Wall, and another of the All Sports Cafe cars. That's Michael Cullen's partner, or his teammate, as they assume. And look at Files late on the brakes, and the little 1600 VTEC just nipped through on Kerrigan.
And you've got to remember, Jonathan Files has been mainly racing in Formula Opel this year. He was very much to the fore of saloon cars last year, but now returns really, I think, to his first love. He loves the saloon car driving. We're on board with Kieran Green in the left hooker. A very successful, rather old car, but still going strong. And look at this, trouble, he locks up. He's back, it's hitting. In fact, Michael Cullen, and I'm afraid he's damaged that car. We look to see if there's steam coming out of it. He's pulling off. He must have held the radiator. That was a major impact.
Major, if you watch it again, you'll see that Gordon himself are really fighting, and poor Michael Cullen, we're looking at it, it's an innocent bystander. Gordon's bringing him in deep. He's well locked up, no steering, he's just understeering across the road. And a good and well done to Michael Cullen for holding on to that. We're on board now with Kieran. You'll see, watch the wheel being turned. He's trying to get it on the steering. Cullen now just about to turn the corner, but the wheels are turned, but going nowhere, only straight. And Gordon has got to go around the back of him, so he moves up a place. So now it's between Cullen and Kellett as they head down. Just one more, watch for the little puff of smoke from the green and black car as he locks his wheel. He's now out of control, he's turned the wheel, but that Peugeot is going nowhere, only into the back of Michael Cullen. Now watch how Gordon just nips across the back of him. Cullen holds it brilliantly, but he's side by side, and Gordon has the inside line.
And Gordon's ahead as they come down into move over Butterfurly Glen Quarter. What a mouthful. And there is Gordon Kellett now up into, I think it's third place at the moment. You can see him really fighting at the wheel. Very, very slow hairpin that indeed. And the little Opel Astras, who are really out of the power game here at Phoenix Park. Very, very fast circuit. Just three sides of a triangle and virtually flat out between the hairpins.
Yes, and these two now battling for that fourth place. Remember, we still have Ed O'Connor up front, plus the two Hondas, but the Honda at the moment that's making all the impression is young Jonathan Files. Out again onto the Dunlop straight. You can see how Michael really working hard from that narrow road out onto the 60 feet wide Dunlop, and using all the road right out to the grass. But Gordon keeping that inside line nicely closed. Cullen having a look at that inside line. This has happened before. We've seen them chipping and tapping. Nothing really heavy duty, but Michael will try to go around the back, but I think Gordon's car just has the legs of him today.
And quite rightly allowed to move over there. We're just looking at Alan Dawson and Dave O'Riordan having their own private little battle towards the back of the field. Dawson, who's a very experienced touring car driver. And there we have somebody on the grass. It looks like Kevin Rowland, number 96, and coming into contact with the Caliber car.
Yes, Kevin Rowland, who raced a number of years here in the Phoenix Park, also in the Sierra, but we're back with this battle for fourth place. Kellett holding that inside line, Cullen trying to get around the back, and they're almost side by side, but can Kellett outdrag him through the S's outside the ordnance survey? This is a hairy moment for both of them, but Kellett just enough room just to zip across and just keep that door closed because that inside line. Meanwhile, O'Connor having an easy race, but this man has something else in his mind. He's in so late on the brakes as they come in. I'm surprised, surprised, the two of them pulling away slowly from Dave Kerrigan. Oh, and a nudge and a hefty nudge that time. Now, whether we got an early break from Gordon or a late break from Michael, we leave it between them.
So down the main straight they go. The car's just not so pristine as when they started this race. You can see quite a little bit of body damage on both cars now. And Cullen way out on the outside, and indeed out breaking himself a little bit there. He lost out badly. Very, very hard to judge. You're coming down these huge straights at high speed. Here we see the replay. This is on the previous corner. This is where they actually made contact. And I would have to say that I think Michael was giving him a little bit of assistance there.
I think the score is 4-1 at the moment. We're on board now with Mark Turley as he heads down towards Dublin Corner. He's been passed by young Dave Feeney.
And Dave Feeney's in the Suzuki Swift, a Group N rally car, and he's racing for Cree and for the West of Ireland Cardiology. So racing for charity out in the Phoenix Park. Not a regular runner in the Dunlop Touring Cars, and indeed Mark Turley going very sideways there as he turned onto the main straight. But we're back with the leader, Ed O'Connor, the man who's also leading the Dunlop Touring Car Championship. And you can see that he is coming up to pass our ailing Turley now, who really is in big trouble, way, way down on par.
Yes, Mark, not having a good day, but look in the background, the other Honda, exactly the same Honda as Mark Turley's, that is Files, lost a little ground there, coming too late, but oh, Turley just getting by Feeney there, thinking this is how it used to be, waving to his pal, but he's been dropped by the much quicker and much healthier other Honda.
So it's Renault, Honda, and then we have to wait, these are two back markers, and then we're looking for Kerrigan in the next Honda. There he is, just going past now on the main back straight, on the Coca-Cola straight there, and then hard on the brakes. This is almost a blind corner. There's a slight brow as you come into it, very hard to judge, but that car is being beautifully driven by Ed O'Connor, who's really having tremendous success with it this year.
I don't think there's anything Jonathan Files, good and all as he is, and don't just underestimate Ed O'Connor, equally as good and equally important to him to win this race, the first one of the weekend. And in the background, David Kerrigan, slightly disappointed he will be. He wasn't really mad about the brakes on this car out here in the Phoenix Park, but it should be as good. They're coming up now to take the checkered flag. We think it is Ed O'Connor as he wins the first of the weekend. We're on board now with Cullen. Remember, that battle's still going on with Gordon Kellett. He comes to Kellett, still holding that line, and Cullen using all the road, but it's Kellett up into fourth base and Cullen in fifth.
And past the start-finish line, and it's not often that Gordon Kellett gets one over in Cullen, but he certainly has today. So there's the finishing order. Yet another win for Ed O'Connor and the Renault Williams Clio. Joan Moore from Dunlop presents the prizes to Ed O'Connor. In second place, Jonathan Files. He'll be very happy about that. And in third place, an excellent drive again from David Kerrigan.
Last year here at the Phoenix Park, we literally drooled over the 250F Maseratis, the ERAs and the Cooper Bristols. They were the early front-engined Grand Prix cars. In fact, when the modern championship, as we know it, began in 1950, front engines dominated the scene. Then in 1958, this little baby came along. It was little compared to the Maseratis. As you can see, it's rear-engined, and it's the Cooper Climax. I'm getting out of my depth again here, so where's Steve? Steve, I've just been sitting in that beautiful 1958 Coventry Climax there, and I see from this 1964 Brabham that it's got a Coventry Climax engine as well. Can you tell me a little bit about the history?
Beautiful car, very effective in its day. Got the classical layout of the rear engine single-seater, which pervades right up until today. If you look at modern single-seaters, the twin wishbone suspension, coil spring damper units.
It really is hard to believe it's 33 years old, isn't it?
It is indeed, and of course the car beautifully presented. All the drivers and owners of these cars nowadays want to see them in original condition, but they are racing cars, they do race them hard, they get used for the purpose which they're intended rather than sitting in museums.
It was nice to have you back again this weekend.
Yes, I think they're fabulous, and to see the cars in a setting here at Phoenix Park of the sort of places they would have raced, proper road circuits, is terrific stuff.
We're looking at the second era of the modern Grand Prix car. In addition to the obvious move from front to rear engine, there is also the drastic reduction in engine size from 2.5 litre to 1.5 litre. So Grand Prix cars really became rather small, rather like a current Formula Ford. This was also the era of the introduction of the monocoque design. Instead of the space frame chassis, which you can see here in a frayed, a rather damaged form, Colin Chapman of Lotus introduced the aluminium or magnesium alloyed tub. The IMRC and Leinster Motor Clubs have gathered over 20 of these valuable cars from the mid-50s and 60s, many of them owned by Irishman Ian Pugh, who is seen here in his glorious 1968 BRM P133, the most recent model of this glorious display. The Rothmans historic Formula One Grand Prix is the highlight of a glorious weekend. Not initially, I'm afraid, glorious for Rod Jolly, number 26, in his 1958 Cooper Climax, who makes a rather slow start. Steve Foster in his Brabham BT21, originally a Formula Junior car, leads. And there's that glorious BRM with the day-glow orange nose of Ian Pugh. And what a sight these cars make as they head down the rather bumpy and narrow approach down to Ferry Glen. And a great, great variety, but way out in front, Steve Foster at the moment. And there's the man in trouble, Rod Jolly. And he's looking down, he's obviously having some kind of gear selection, some kind of problem there, and not as big a problem as Marshall Bailey in his Brabham BT11, a 1964 model, who spins off there. There's Jolly, 26 now, beginning to get the cargo right as he gobbles up some of these rather beautifully prepared Formula Junior Brabhams. And indeed, I can remember a BT23 residing in Ireland. But there's the man, BT21A, still in the lead, and the larger Formula One car now right up behind him. Somebody waving another gaggle through there, number 20 just on the right there. That looks like Jeff Williams, his Cooper 1957 car. So quite an age variety there. Jolly now, right on the tail, should have the speed in the straight line. Indeed he has. And he devours the little Brabham BT21 as it breaks for Dublin Corner. Lovely shot there. These cars are really a joy to observe and beautifully prepared and bringing all kinds of memories back. John Pringle, do you remember him in the Cooper Climax? The man from Bangor who won just about everything in Ireland in his day. But it's Rod Jolly's day today. Cooper wins, Brabham second, Lotus third, all the glorious names.
And now for the naughty boys, the Fiat Unos. They're a nice bunch, really. But put these little angels into their racers, and they can only be described as men and one woman behaving badly. So much so that, as you may have seen in our last RPM, the whole race was declared null and void. However, there's no championship points at stake here, so maybe they'll be a little better behaved somehow. I doubt it.
And this is the grid for the Fiat Auto World Uno racing the Sunday. It's Barrable and Cullen on the front row, O'Donoghue, then Clive Pratt, Michael Conway and Liam Rabbit. And we're on board with Liam Denning, who's way down the back, and our other camera car is David Pratt. But look at the star from Barrable. Tucks it in on the right-hand side. Keep that inside closed. Then is Cullen, Carlo O'Donoghue. Then Clive Pratt thinks he knows a way down the outside. And Liam Rabbit thinks he can go a lot quicker. And in the middle of all, this is Denning just up on top of Sean Woods, having to make his way all the way up from the back. Oh, and his spinner there, Riley. We're on the grass now with David Pratt escaping that run by Riley. And Riley, we've seen him on his roof in Mondello Park. But look at these Fiats head over towards move over corner. These guys won't move over.
32 of them streaming down into Ferry Glen. What a situation. Identical motor cars with no power advantage and just all fighting for road. Going through the cement dust of the oil dropped by previous races, hard on the brakes. And Barry Barrable has got a good, clean run. He can keep out of trouble. The others are almost indefinitely in trouble.
Cullen at the moment. Now again we're on board with Liam Denning as he jumps nips by Brendan Travers, and he is storming up through the field. But look at Barrable just pulling away at the moment from Michael Cullen. O'Donoghue under a little bit of pressure there from Clive Pratt, and in the background we see Michael Conway still holding off Liam Rabbit out of the little narrow Ferry Glen straight out onto this wide Dunlop straight. You can see the Sooners losing all the ground. Again, we're back on board again with Denning, looking at the inside there of Levy's car, number 8, as they head towards Dublin Corner. In the background, you see them side by side. And again. Look at Michael Cullen trying to get out on that long wide line, cutting across. Will he touch? Getting in very close. He just catches the back of Michael Barra, or should say Barry Barrowell's car, and spins him, or half spins him. And again, Levy just gets through there, so Denning has it all to do again.
Oh, and World War III going on now at Dublin. 23 there goes straight on.
Stephen Kellett just around the tyres and back out onto the road. Unfortunately, not everybody gets away so lightly at this corner.
Meanwhile, we're halfway down the straight once again towards the ferried lane. A little bit more spread out this time, but not up front. Michael Cullen putting on a determined challenge to Barry Barrowell. And look at O'Donoghue there. They're all together. Tremendous racing. Then Prash.
Then Michael Conway and then Liam Rabbit. We're back on board again with Pratt. And that's Quinton Wall just heading out there towards the Dublin corner. But look how low these little Unos are. Making a straight line of it, Barry, at the moment. Wanting to get away from Michael Cullen. Donoghue at the moment wanting to get away from Clive Pratt. That is on board with Denning. He's got a lot of work to do, and working he is as they come back down. Heading back out onto the short main street. And O'Donoghue begin to close in on top of Cullen. And Clive Pratt hasn't given up late. And look, he just catches it on the grass. And then catches one of the tires, sets it up in the air. And that was very close to being a roof job.
Well, that's going to be an expensive repair there for the Carlo man. Rear wheel just spinning still. Because underneath those tires is a concrete plinth. And that can do an awful lot of damage. First three now pulled away a little bit.
And look at Donoghue's getting up alongside Michael Cullen. Cullen going extremely wide there. Denning still having this battle with Levy, but they're side by side. Now, unfortunately, or fortunately for Michael or Carl, depending who you're shouting for, the inside line is very slippy. And Barry at the moment is hoping these two will keep at this nonsense, keeping each other nice and slow. They're coming through. This is very quick indeed. As quick as you can go, down they go, side by side. Donoghue on the slippy inside. And he gets it just slightly out of its twist, but he holds it brilliantly. And Michael Cullen backing off there. That's known as a tank slapper. And some tank slapper. He's finally got by Denning, finally gets by Levy as they head down now into this 40 Glen corner. But Barrowell out front. Now he's got O'Donoghue in the mirrors. Then Cullen, and Liam Rabbit got by Michael Conway.
So Liam Rabbit moving up, Liam Denning moving up. Denning is the man, in fact, that is leading the Dunlop Fiat Uno Championship. He's had a very successful season. That's when the races actually have gone the full distance. But there's O'Donoghue, number 42, Carl O'Donoghue, being chased at the moment by Michael Cullen in the All Sports Cafe car. And out front, Barry Barrowell, who the man who transferred back to Fiat Uno's, he raced in the Dunlop Touring cars last year, and really swapped over with Michael Barrowell, who was the champion at Fiat Uno's, his brother.
Carl O'Donoghue there in second place. His brother Miles also out in this race, and he's under pressure from Michael Cullen. Now let's see. Liam Rabbit, Michael Conway, and Liam Denning up into sixth place. His superb drive. Oh, this is a little bit of nonsense. Unfortunately, that is Miles O'Donoghue, who I was mentioning, having a coming together with Quinton Wall and raising his fist. I don't think he's too happy with that. Back meanwhile, Conway there, under pressure still from Rabbit, then Levy, and then it's Quinn in the car that we saw Ronnie Griffin put on its roof. Again, look at the drive this man Denning is having. He's looking at fifth place. Could he be looking at fourth? Second place, Donoghue there in the blue and STP car. The All Sports Cafe of Cullen gets into third, but all the time Denning in the background there. The six of these in the spin there. Quinn just catching the back of that car. Lap six out of eight. And it's still Barry, but I think we've got a problem. A lot of smoke from underneath Barry Barrowell's car as he heads down towards Dublin. And Cullen has got by O'Donoghue. So this, everything is going to change. They go into the Dublin Crystal corner.
So Michael Cullen still under very strict attention there from Carl Donoghue. And we've got an overtaking. It looks like Liam Denning and the Rathdan motors car going up place there. Yes, Denning ahead of the sound lighting car. And there he's changing up, just looking in his mirror, checking out. Lamming it through the gears, right up into fourth by the time of the end of the ferry land, and more wars.
David Breach there just spun off with Mark Marks in number 71. And yet another one there, that's Chris Byrne. I think this is a little more. Watch this. This is Breach, just catches it under braking, spins it out. Nothing really bad. That's one of the Pratt's, Nigel Pratt there getting in, but this is the one. It just caught him there. Chris Byrne coming down the inside. Catches the door of Mark Regan, and that is a biggie. You'll see the door now and how much the damage There it is, down in the dip. Marshall checking the driver. Meanwhile, we're back out. We did think he was in trouble. Barry Barrable has now moved back to third place. So it is Cullen from Donoghue, from Barrable.
Just approaching the start of the final lap now, and this is absolutely anybody's race. Cullen still leads from Carlo Donoghue, and Barrable's car, despite that smoke, you can still see a little whiff of it coming out there from under the car. Must be overheating. Carlo Donoghue tries to go around the outside. He's gone wide. He's going to lose. Surely a place, yes. Barrable's up into second, but look at Liam Denning now. He could take third.
Denning decided, you want to make those mistakes, I'm ready here for you. Ah, and Quinn just coming down again into the back, and somebody going on straight. That's Richardson. Are we somebody else involved? We have indeed, and that there is Brendan Travers, number 14, off in the grass, but he gets going again. We're back on board with Denning, looking for that third place. Up front is Barrable, and still Cullen leading, but look at the battle at the moment. Denning on the outside, nudging, putting a wheel on the grass. That's what's known as closing the door a little late. Something wrong there with Denning's car. Seems to have lost a little bit of bodywork, may have done damage. He's lost out to Liam Rabbit, and he's lost out to Michael Conway.
And 32 cars started this race. How many are going to be finishing? We'll be lucky if they're 20. The first three look fairly secure, however, and poor Liam Denning pulling off there. What a shame after a great, great drive. But Barrable hasn't given up yet. Is Michael Cullen going to take yet another victory? He's getting a little bit of assistance from behind. And all these drivers being very closely watched by the officials.
Yes, indeed. These three have to pull there. But a good dice, a superb race. But it's Cullen from Barrable, from Carlo Donoghue. Then a great drive from Liam Rabbit and Michael Conway, who kept all their noses clean.
But once again in the Dunlop Fiat Unos, the result is subject to appeal.
Men behaving not too badly. What a great weekend it's been.
Yeah, I gotta say that the highlight of the weekend for me was the historics. And you know, this particular meeting at the Phoenix Park is becoming more and more important for the international historic racing class, along of course with the Goodwood Festival of Speed and the Coys meeting at Silverstone.